Good morning, everyone. My name is Agnese Callegari, and this is the second part of the basic introduction to classical molecular dynamics. In the first part, we have tested our numerical integration schemes to see how they perform in cases where we know the analytical solutions. In this second part, we will give two examples of systems with more than one particle, okay? The first one is the gas, two-dimensional gas of Lennard-Jones particles. So we have these small particles that are sort of rigid disks that interact with each other via the Lennard-Jones potential. The Lennard-Jones potential is used to describe interaction between simple atoms and molecules. For example, the van der Waals interaction is modeled with this kind of potential. And you see how this potential behaves in this plot. You notice here we have parameters like sigma and epsilon. R is the distance between two particles. Sigma is what is called the particle size and is a sort of unit of length of our systems. And epsilon is the energy, this energy scale of the system. So this plot here has is expressed expresses VR in units of epsilon against the distance expressed in units of sigma. So if two particles are more distant than 3 sigma, then they practically do not interact with each other. The interaction is negligible. If their centers come closer than 2.5 sigma, they start feeling each other and they feel a light attraction. Then they reach an equilibrium point. And if they come closer than that equilibrium point, they experience a very strong repulsion. For this system, it is common to define these sort of units, adimensional units, like this given unit of mass, energy, length. And from these, you define the units of force, velocity, time, and temperature. Why this? Because the interaction, this is a sort of quite universal, let's say. So if I'm thinking of a specific system like, a gas of argon atoms, I will have a given amount of mass for each particle, and I will have a specific energy scale and a specific particle size. In another system, I will have different values, but if I normalize everything, everything will be described by this potential. Also, this normalization to these units allows us to use numbers that are close to unity. And this is this helps us to avoid numerical errors in our simulation because we are in the range where the processor works better. So for my simulation, I set mass equal to 1, energy equal to 1, size equal to 1, velocity, I arbitrarily set it equal to 2. So to start our simulation, we have to decide how many particles we are going to simulate. In this case, for this explanatory picture, I put 36 particles. Then I distributed the particles initially on a square lattice, okay? So this allows me to avoid the superpositions. Then I gave them the same initial speed and I set the velocity orientation randomly, as you see here. And as a numerical method, I will use the leapfrog method, which is actually equivalent, let's say, to the Verlet algorithm. Then in my numerical integration, I will have to calculate the force. Okay, one important step is each time calculating the forces. Here you see the analytical expression of the force, and here you see how the force behaves. And you, I want you to notice that when the particles are closer than the equilibrium point, the force becomes very repulsive, very quickly, okay? So we have to start our simulation and we have to decide for the time step. I arbitrarily chose this value, the value that you see here, in units of the characteristic time of the system. Why did I do that? I don't know. It seemed a number that is small enough. Let's see if this time step is appropriate for my simulation. So I start it. And yeah, it's evident here that something is wrong. Okay, this is not what I would like to obtain from a numerical simulation. You see, also I started with, I think 100 particles and I'm left with much less. So something has happened. Something unphysical, okay, has happened. What can it be? So let's try to pay a bit of attention. So initially the simulation seems fine and then the first collisions occur. Now pay attention to what happens here. You see, there is a first collision, a second one, and in the second one, you see the particles seem to overlap a bit. So they are experiencing a lot of force. And then further, you see further collisions. You see this collision here, even more overlap. And another collision, oops. Okay, let's see if I can get it. No. Okay, another collision and another collision. And you see that the simulation runs easily out of control. Okay? So what can be the problem in this case? Because clearly this is not a correct behavior for a physical system. I do not observe things like that. So it is something that is a problem of the simulation. So most likely the first thing that after excluding of having implemented the correct expression of the force and other features, maybe the problem is the time step. Why I say so? Physically, the evolution of a system is continuous. Physically, you don't have a time step. However, in numerical simulation, we must introduce a specific time step and move the system in jumps. If the time step is too big, and for example, the particles are already close enough, maybe proceeding with that time step, I set the position in, set the particles one time step further in an unphysical position that they would never reach physically because my time evolution is discrete. So we have tried to avoid this occurrence. So maybe we should decrease our time step even further. So let's try to see what happens with this time step, which seems to be much smaller. Let's see. And actually now things seem to be normal. Actually, if you notice, I didn't set the initial velocity too big for the particles. So you can sometimes see that the particles are forming a sort of bound states like a biatomic molecule, which is actually fine. So if I had set the velocity, the initial velocity much bigger, maybe I wouldn't have observed this phenomenon. Okay, so let's come to another example. And this is an example that want to exemplify how from a deterministic set of equations, we can find something that behave in a stochastic way. So we are trying to mimic what happens to a big particle when it interacts with a lot of smaller particles. And this is actually a model for Brownian motion, okay? So Brownian motion is a characteristic of light object, for example, a grain of dust suspended in air. And you see that you all have experienced this. If you observe the motion of some dust in the air, it sort of moves erratically. We are trying now to see if we can obtain a motion like this one. So let's start our simulation. And it seems like the motion of the green particle is sort of erratic, okay? Irregular. We cannot really predict from the condition it has at a given instant where it will go afterwards. Okay, so let's stop our simulation here and let's go on. Let me share a few details about the simulation I was running. I choose a set of particles, small particles. I assigned them a mass, and that was much smaller of the mass of the green particle. Much smaller means the mass here is 1, and I think I set like 20 or 30 times. The mass of the green particle is 20 or 30 times bigger than the mass of the small particles. Then I didn't consider the interaction between the small particles just for simplicity, in order to run the numerical simulation in a decent amount of time on my computer. I considered the interactions only between the big disk and the small disks. Again, for initializing the simulation, I set the position of the particles. I set also the position of the disk. I set it at the center of the box, and I put it initially at rest. While for the particles, I put the same initial speed for everyone, and again, a random orientation of the velocities. So here, let me run the simulation again. And here, let me show after the simulation has completed, I plot the trajectory of the green disk. And you see, the trajectory seems irregular, and we have the idea that maybe we have simulated Brownian motion. So from a set of deterministic interactions, because we have a lot of small particles that collide with the big particle, maybe we have been able to reproduce what is called the Brownian motion. To see if this is a real Brownian motion or not, we should check the trajectory we have obtained. I don't enter now in the detail of the definition of the mean square displacement, but as you will learn from Aykut's lecture about active Brownian motion, you will know that there are ways of characterizing some the trajectories of particles. And one way is to analyze the mean square displacement that we obtain from the trajectory. Brownian motion is characterized by a linear dependence of the mean square displacement with respect to the time interval we consider. And actually, in this plot, let's say it looks linear enough, okay? Of course, usually we don't express the plot with two linear axes, but we use the bilogarithmic axis. So it's a more normal way of representing the mean square displacement. However, I will let this part to Aykut. Before concluding, let me spend a few words about the workflow of a numerical simulation when we have a lot of particles and we want, for example, to describe some thermodynamic system, for example, a gas, something like that. So in any numerical simulation, you have an initialization part. Then you have what you have called equilibration and control. So what is equilibration? When you are dealing with some thermodynamic system, you know that you usually have to consider the variables describing its macroscopic state when the system is at equilibrium, thermodynamic equilibrium. Thermodynamic equilibrium has a certain characterization. So for example, we know in a perfect gas that the velocity distribution of the particles should follow a given distribution. But in our initial condition, usually we decide to set the particles all with the same speed. So this initial condition is not for sure the part of the equilibrium state of the system. So we have to give the system a bit of time to evolve from the initial state to the thermodynamic equilibrium. And this happens via the collisions between the particles, okay? So you start the simulation, you let the system evolve, and after a reasonable amount of time, you can say that you have you have come closer to the equilibrium. For knowing if you are close to the equilibrium or not, you have to monitor the value of the thermodynamic variable that are describing the system, okay? And then you have sometimes to control your simulation. So, again, in a thermodynamic system, we have several variables describing its state. For example, the particle number, the volume, the pressure, the temperature, the total energy. And of course, they are not all independent. They are related by some equation of state. Depending on the conditions of the system that you are investigated, you might have a certain variables that are external ones and certain that are depending on those settings. For example, in our simulation of the Lennard-Jones gas, we had these variables that were constant, the particle number, the volume, and the total energy. So we had the collisions, but as the force is a conservative force, the total energy should be a constant. However, not all physical processes happen in these conditions. Sometimes we want to study a process happening at constant temperature, okay? Usually, actually, in experiment, we have processes going on at constant temperature or constant pressure. So we do not, we have different quantities that are to be kept stable, not always particle, number of particles or volume or total energy. So we will have to have additional algorithms for controlling our system. For example, if we want constant temperature, we will have to have an algorithm to change the total energy. Or if we want constant pressure, we should accordingly change the volume. So, for example, if we are considering a process happening at constant temperature, we will have to have an algorithm that changes the total energy and adds or remove energy to the system so that the temperature is kept constant. Such an algorithm, for example, is called a thermostat. And there are several ways of implementing it. We will have a small example in the exercises about it. Let me spend a few words about the example of the Brownian disk. So in this system, we were considering all the particles, so small particles and big particles as part of a single system, okay? However, if we consider two parts, so on one side, we consider the disk, and on the other side, we consider the small particles. Those systems are interacting, so they interact through the collisions. And actually, the big disk acts as a sort of a reservoir of heat. So by colliding with the small particle, it exchanges momentum and energy. And sometimes it provides a small amount of energy, and sometimes it takes a small amount of energy. So it sort of helps thermalizing the system. So it's a sort of rudimental thermostat. Okay, so in conclusion, I've tried to give an elementary introduction to molecular dynamics. We started with the two basic methods, Euler's algorithm and the leapfrog algorithm. And we analyzed how they performed in cases where we had the analytical solutions in one and two dimensions. Then we have seen a few example systems in with many particles interacting with the Lennard-Jones potentials. Potential, and we have tried to see if we can simulate something that resembles Brownian motion. And then we have spent a few words about how to control a numerical simulation. So I hope I've given a taste of how numerical simulation of molecular dynamics are. And I would like to thank you for your attention, and to say that this presentation is part of the initial training on numerical methods for active matter, organized by the Active Matter ITN. And I hope you enjoyed the lecture, and you will enjoy the following lectures by the other speakers of the training. So thank you very much.